In this episode, we're going to be giving you an update on our FD RX7 project car. We're also going to be talking about our blown Toyota 1U ZFE, and I don't mean blown in the good way. It doesn't have a supercharger on it. It's got a massive hole in the side of the block. We're also going to be talking about the 3UZ engine that we've chosen as a donor, why we've gone that way, and what we're going to be doing with it. So a quick update with our FD RX7 project. It is dangerously close to going brap brap. But there's still a little bit of work to do. We'll just update you on where that's at. So the engine bay now looking a little bit more complete. We've got the intake on our 8474 turbo. The turbo, the Turblown kit, everything, all of the hot parts there are basically installed for the final time, with the exception of the exhaust front pipe. Just needs the V-band clamp around it. So that's all in there. We've got our Vinny Fab V-mount intercooler and radiator set up. So that's all looking good in there. And again, in for the final time. One of the parts that we've just had from Vinny Fab is this radiator overflow, swirl pot, header tank, whatever you like to call it. Basically, it replaces the factory cast item that sits in there. Nothing specifically wrong with the factory item, it's a little bit ugly and I'm being picky there. Also an update on that drive-by-wire throttle conversion that we've been doing. So again, a little bit hard to see, but the mount is in there for the final time. Let's just get the GoPro down and we'll see if we can actually see it properly. So that's all mounted up for the final time. And Barry has also, I probably can't call you Barry, that joke doesn't really carry across to the internet, does it? It's Brandon. We call him Barry. It's Brandon Barry. He's got two first names. What the hell? Who does that? Anyway, part of that, he also had to redesign the bell crank. So we've got a new bell crank sitting here on the factory FD RX7 throttle body. At this point, we've got a little rod here to actuate that, which you can see runs straight down. So as I was trying to sort of explain to start with the location of that drive-by-wire motor, that rod that Brandon's made up has basically got a straight shot up to the throttle body. So should all work, hopefully. We need to power it up obviously with the electronic ECU and just make sure that it does do everything it should, but it's all looking pretty positive right now. The other thing we've done with the Mazda RX7 throttle body is we have removed one of the return springs on it, and that's going to require a little bit of testing. Obviously the return spring, there is a safety element of this. There is still a return spring in there, but what we want to do is just make sure that we're not overpowering or working the drive-by-wire throttle motor too hard, and if it has to overcome too much spring pressure, it could be problematic. So it's going to be a bit of testing once we get it up and running. Of course, the drive-by-wire throttle motor does have its own internal return spring, so we're not eliminating the safety aspects there, but it'll be a bit of a trial and error to see how that all pans out. While we're waiting for the wiring harness to be finished off, Brandon has also been installing some of the battery cabling into the car, and we've mounted the battery inside the cabin. We're only using a small battery, and it's a lot of room actually left in the engine bay to mount that battery, so it was pretty hard to find a good spot. What that required was the power and ground cables to come through the firewall. We wanted to do that in a neat way that was going to be easy to work with, and while it's not exactly a new product, we ended up settling on using the Radlock product, which I'll show you down here. It actually comes through where the existing air conditioning used to come through, so you can see those. Brendan's made up a nice 3D printed mount with a positive mark here, so you can't get it wrong. And removing these just simply requires you to push this little button in here, a bit hard to do with one hand, and you can simply remove that. So it's a nice little stud there. It's insulated, so it's not going to short out on the body. Really easy to install and remove those with no tools. That really didn't seem that easy, did it? I swear it's pretty easy. But I'll admit that looked like a bit of a ball ache. Brandon's also been busy on Fusion 360, designing a few more parts for the car, so let's go and have a look at those. Now, we have chosen to get rid of the factory oil metering pump. The idea with these is that they inject oil basically into the rotor housing from the sump. Now, a long time ago when our ECUs weren't as advanced as they were now, it was quite difficult to find an ECU that would adequately drive the oil metering pump. It's basically a stepper motor design. These days, not such a problem, but people have sort of gone the route of removing that and using two-stroke premix essentially in the fuel instead. pros and cons on both ways, but that's the way we've gone. So we needed to end up blanking off where this is driven on the side of the 13B engine. So Brandon designed up this little bracket here. You can see it's got an integrated O-ring in it, so that's going to seal against the engine block. Pretty simple design, just 3 bolts holding that on. At the same time, Brandon's also designed up a battery mount for us. So this is the little battery that we're going to be using here, and this nice solid CNC alloy machined housing, sorry, mount for that battery. So that's something that we're going to be able to use on a few of our cars as well. So it's going to come in handy aside from the RX7 project. Well, we've covered the drive-by-wire throttle motor in the engine bay. The other part, obviously, is the pedal assembly. And of course, the RX7 comes with this plastic pedal that's set up for cable throttle. There's a few ways of doing this and converting. What we wanted to do was use an existing drive-by-wire throttle pedal assembly, and we ended up inheriting one from a GM vehicle. So what we did there was, again, Brandon used his Fusion 360 skills and our 3D printer and made up this nice little adapter bracket here. So this adapts to the firewall on one side and the GM throttle pedal on the other side. Of course, this is just a prototype. We're not going to be leaving it in plastic. It will be machined in alloy once we've confirmed everything works. Now, one of the aspects here that's important is to make sure that the spacing of the pedal suits the application. And this can be quite important, making sure that you can still heel and toe on the downshift, so the pedal sits right in comparison to the brake pedal, and also it's not going to foul on any other parts of the chassis while it's going through its full range of movement. Now, on that first test that Brandon printed out, the spacing wasn't quite right and actually sat a little bit high. So this is really one of the advantages with 3D prototyping. We get to test that out before we commit to having it made in an expensive material such as alloy in the CNC machining process. Once we decided it was too high, Brandon just modified his design, shortened it up a little bit, and the second test worked out perfect.
Yeah, boy. Boom.
There you go, a quick update to get you up to speed on where we're at with the FD RX7 project. Not long to go, really excited to turn the key for the first time. We haven't really had the most successful race season. Between braking axles and general reliability, we've had a problem getting to the end of a 1 hour endurance meeting. So that's not really the best way to start our first season of endurance racing. And Ben actually ended it in quite a spectacular fashion at the last race I couldn't go to, but he went there and raced solo. And I think it was about 7 minutes from the end, I ended up putting a pretty big hole in the side of our block. Let's have a look at the aftermath. So here is our existing 1UZ FE engine. Obviously we've got it in pieces a little bit. You definitely don't want to be seeing a hole like that in the side of your block. There's the connecting rod. It wasn't the connecting rod that let go. And we're still not 100% sure. We may never know exactly what went wrong, because when an engine lets go at about 8,700 RPM, normally there's not a lot of good stuff left over. What we think's happened is that it's dropped a valve. It still runs the factory Toyota cast pistons, so they're not particularly strong. And if it drops a valve, then the piston's basically going to shatter to pieces, punches what's left of the piston outside the block, and the rest is history. Because that happened at 8,700 RPM, we don't really have a lot of engine left. Certainly the block is toast, that's a throwaway. The head's not really recoverable either, so we decided that we would start fresh with a new motor, or a new donor motor anyway. Because we aren't limited by capacity for our class, we decided to step up and go to a 4.3 litre 3UZ FE. And there's also a 4.7 litre engine in the 1UZ, 2UZ, 3UZ family, the 2UZ FE, but that's a truck engine and it uses a cast iron block.
gives me more capacity, but it's a lot more weight. We don't really want any more weight over the front axle line. So while 4.7 litres would have been nice, we decided to stick to the 3UZ. Gives us another 300 cc's of capacity with some tricks around offset grinding the crankshaft as well as a larger bore diameter. We can overbore it by 1 millimetre. We're going to be getting ourselves up to just under 4.5 litres. So healthy improvement over the 4 litres we're at. We're hoping to increase our power by around about 100 horse. So here is the donor motor that we're dealing with. So this is fresh from a wrecking yard. We don't really have a lot of history on this engine, and as you can see, I'm actually in the middle of pulling this apart for a worked example for one of our engine building courses. So I've already got one of the cylinder heads off here. I'm just about to pull off the cylinder head for the right bank. We can take a look here. You can see everything looks like it's in pretty good condition. We don't really care too much because we are replacing all of the components and we will be overboring the engine. So basically, as long as we don't have a hole in the side of the block, we're going to be good to go here. One of the things with the UZ family of Toyota engines is that they use a reasonably weird scissor drive arrangement for the cam. So basically there is only one cam sprocket at the top of the engine driven off the cam belt. And then this drives the inlet cam, and the exhaust cam is driven off a gear from the inlet cam. Sounds complex, but you're about to see that in a second, and it's actually not that tricky. There are a couple little considerations you want to make when you are pulling that apart though. So let's get into this now. I'm going to pull that other cylinder head off, and when we get to that point, I'm going to show you what I'm talking about here. It's going to save you a lot of trouble if you don't know this little trick. So first of all, just really unrelated to building the engine at all, one of the things that I always look for if I'm trying to find a secondhand engine from a wrecking yard, it's a good idea to take the time and just pull the rocker cover off to get a better idea of the condition inside. So we really want to see something like we've got here, that nice kind of honey glazed color. And that's pretty much indicative that the engine has had a pretty good maintenance history. It's had regular oil changes. So if you end up pulling the rocker cover off and it's just full of black crud and carbon buildup and deposits, that isn't the end of the world. You can definitely still recover from it, but it just indicates that that engine maybe hasn't had the best maintenance history. While I am stripping the engine, there's just a couple of things that you want to keep in mind here on the 3UZ or the 1UZ VVTi as well. Same really. And this is to do with the intake cam sprocket. So if we have a look at that, we can see it here. So the inside workings of that allowed the cams to be advanced and retarded while the engine's running. Now we actually need to take that outer sprocket off in order to fully disassemble the engine and remove that cam. And it's really important when you do that. You can see we've got these little M6 bolts with the 10mm caps. We've got four of those, the 10mm heads, I should say. We've got four of those around there. And then we've got these inner ones, these darker ones, which have a Torx head inside them. Don't take those out by accident. When we're doing this, all we want to do is take off those M6 bolts, all four of them, and then we can remove the cam drive component off that sprocket. If you do undo those Torx head fasteners, you're going to end up with that whole VVT pulley springing apart. There's a big spring in there, and generally it doesn't end well. I ended up finding this out the hard way. It's actually on an older Toyota Beams 3SGE engine, and ended up pulling one of the cam drive sprockets apart, and I can tell you it's not a lot of fun trying to piece that back together. So don't do that by accident. Now let's move on and we'll have a look at that process. One of the problems you'll probably face is even once you've got those four M6 bolts out of the way, that outside section is actually pretty firmly fixed on, and it's pretty easy to get that off. You're not going to be able to do it by hand, but simple little trick is you're just going to get a plastic mallet. Now don't worry, it's not going to do any damage to the cam drive sprocket. What it's just going to do is free that up. So just a couple of gentle hits around the outside there, and hopefully if everything works, yeah, there you go, easy as that. Heaps attached, get involved, get real brutal with it. Yeah, it's not working, is it? Oh no, it worked, there you go. Now that I've got the engine stripped down a little bit further, we can have a better look at how the cams are actually actuated. So let's have a look here. Obviously, we've only got the one cam sprocket, and that drives the intake cam here. Then the exhaust cam is driven off this gear here on the intake cam. So this is called a scissor drive arrangement. The problem with this is that the mesh between these two gears, if it's not dealt with properly, does result in some backlash, and particularly that creates a huge amount of noise. Now, that's not really something that's particularly nice. So what Toyota have done is they've used this split two-piece gear here on the exhaust cam. And this is kind of spring-loaded. And what it does is it takes up some of that lash and reduces that noise, basically eliminating it. So the problem here is that if we just take these cams out, because that's spring loaded, this is just going to ping, and it's not unrecoverable, but it's going to make your life a lot harder when it comes to putting everything back together. So the little pro tip here is if we go around this side, we'll see that there is a hole in the back of the cam there, and all we want to do is get an M6 bolt that's about the right length. Doesn't have to be anything too flash, and we can just screw that in. We want to make sure we do this while the cams are still together, and we tighten that up. Basically, it's going to just lock up that scissor drive arrangement, and that's going to mean that when we do get to a point of undoing the cams and removing them, that's not going to spring into the wrong location. It's all going to be nice and locked up when we come to putting the cams back together. So again, not unrecoverable, but it's definitely going to make your life a lot easier.
Thanks for watching. And if you like that, make sure you give us a thumbs up. If you've got questions on anything we talked about, ask those in the comments. And if you haven't already, make sure you subscribe to our channel. This will make sure you don't miss out on any future content that we put out. Next week, we're going to be talking about our new project car. Well, new to us, but it's certainly not brand new. It's a classic 1980s Toyota FJ40. Bit of a departure from our normal angle here at High Performance Academy, but we're going to be keeping that classic appeal while modernizing the FJ40 with modern running gear and electronics.